I am a public health professional. My background has been in life sciences and public health. I've worked in different capacities in this sector over the last several years. And for the last 3.5 years or a bit more than that, I've been working with the NITI Aayog, which is the premier policy think tank of the Indian government. And we work primarily with both ministries at the central level, as well as with the various state governments in India, to help with the implementation of various policies, to monitor the implementation, to get insights from different levels to improve our policy formulation. So that is really the overarching sort of role of NITI Aayog. And my work here focuses on the social sector areas, health, nutrition, sanitation, gender. All of these are very interlinked, as you know. So I work across all of these. And currently, of course, we are involved in a big way with the management of the COVID outbreak in India. We have two different empowered groups that the government of India has set up of high-level officials, which are being chaired by officials of the NITI Aayog. One is on health and managing the sort of medical emergency that we are faced with right now. The other is building relationships with different stakeholders, NGOs, private sector, etc., to help us in this response. We are, you know, the second piece of work that I was touching upon, which is our networks that we are building with civil society organizations, with various volunteer groups. We are using these to try and reach out to different groups which are facing particular kind of challenges at this time, and senior citizens or the elderly is obviously one major group which is not only affected by the lockdown. There are various issues that become more difficult for them during such a phase, but they're also more susceptible to you know, getting more serious forms of the disease. In India, of course, we have a much younger demographic, so we don't have as many elderly people as a proportion, you know, as compared to many of the other countries, especially in Europe. But in terms of absolute numbers, we still have large numbers, you know, even relatively small shares of population in India, as you know, are large numbers in terms of, you know, absolute figures. And a lot of these elderly would be vulnerable in different ways. So we are engaging with a lot of organizations working at the grassroots level, engaging with different volunteer groups and volunteer organizations who are well placed to reach out to people in different parts of the country. The government at a time like this is naturally stretched in many directions. There are so many things that we're trying to do, and especially when you have the kind of scale and diversity that we have in India, the challenges get compounded several times. So our objective is to tie up with a lot of these large organizations. We've recently launched an initiative specifically for senior citizens, which is to sort of create awareness about how they need to be protected much more, and you know, they need to be much more careful, and people around them need to take care of them in a sort of much more conscious way at this time. So we were partnered with one of our big foundations here to take this specific initiative forward. So we are doing different things for different groups, whether it's people with disabilities, whether it's women, because they all have the unique set of challenges at a time like this. You know, as I was alluding to, that we have a lot of engagement of people from outside the government. I think it's very clear that any sort of challenge of this magnitude cannot be handled by the government alone. We need, you know, lots of other players to step in, and private sector is one very critical one. In fact, even in our health sector, there is actually a huge role of private players. You know, so whether it's in delivery of healthcare. We are trying to partner with, you know, private sector as closely as possible to, you know, ramp up our bed capacity and ramp up availability of critical equipment at this time. Also on the production side, you know, where we need, you know, more personal protective equipment, or we need more ventilators. So there's a whole piece to involve the private sector in production of that, to ramp up capacity as and when needed. And there's also a whole piece on digital health. So the government and, you know, NITI Aayog, the health ministry, very recently we've launched a set of guidelines on telemedicine. which we think is going to play a very important role, not only during the pandemic, but also beyond that. So we are also engaging with a lot of private players in the field of digital health to see how can we take some of these initiatives forward, which are going to naturally get a fillip at a time when we all have to sort of observe physical distancing. I think policy making, is sort of a very important framework and architecture that it gives you to plan your response to something like this. I think the response eventually has to be at a very micro level, at the ground level. In India, the way you look at, the pandemic has sort of taken shape so far, it isn't spread, evenly across the country. There are certain pockets, there are certain hotspots, the larger urban centers where we are facing a bigger challenge. So naturally, when it comes to delivery, when it comes to, actually containing it on the ground, those are sort of ground level interventions which become very critical. But what supports all of this are the policies, are the guidelines on how do you go about it, because we have to remember that this is something very new for most people. Most people in their lifetime have actually not had an experience of dealing with something like this. So if we just leave it to, people to do as they think best, we will not get a uniform, structured response at some sort of basic level. I think ultimately in a country like India, everything has to be contextualized, everything has to be localized. But we need a basic broad framework. And I think that's what policy making gives you, that whether it's on the healthcare side, whether it's on the management of the economy, because that's another big sort of simultaneous challenge that we are facing here. How do we really go about it? What are the actions we take? And I think that's where policies are very useful at a time like this. Several areas, digital health is one I touched upon, which I think is, something that should get a huge boost, after this, because I think people will be adhering to physical distancing norms for some time to come. It's not a 1 month, 2 month, 3 month sort of issue. This is definitely a long haul for most of the world. So I think in such a situation, we will see whether it's telemedicine, whether it's, the electronic health records, greater investment in building those. Already the government is focused on those in a big way. Whether it is genetics, use of genetics, use of different kinds of tools and finding new drugs, new vaccines, and sort of accelerating our research efforts. So I think a lot of those fields will definitely get a boost. On the manufacturing side, we might, because of how the global dynamics might play out, we might see some players moving out of China. So there is an opportunity for them to shift base to India. And I think there is definitely a lot of thinking and a lot of work going on along those lines as well. That how can we make India a conducive place for a lot of those people to come and sort of set up base here. So I think opportunities of different kinds are really going to open up. It's not going to be all about challenges. I think it will also open up some very unique sort of sectors and opportunities where India can take the lead. We have a very strong, human resource base in many, many sectors, but sort of really linking that in with the right set of tools and technologies, I think is going to then help us to take a lead in many of these sectors. There's learnings, and we're learning every day. I think, as I said, this is something which is evolving all the time. This is not something that, we have been used to, we've seen before. So I think that there are learnings that we are having on the health side, on the economic side. So I would really divide them into sort of short term and more long term. I think in the short term, there's sort of things that we learn almost on a daily basis on how to manage this better, on how to help our informal sector better. India, as you know, we have a large informal sector, and that creates a lot of problems on the economic side. So those are sort of short-term learnings that we're almost having every day, and you see them reflected in sort of government guidelines and decisions. They keep evolving, because that's the very nature of tackling something like this. We cannot decide today, what would be the best option 2 weeks down the line, because a lot might have changed. So I think those are those kind of very short-term learnings, which I think will help our states and help the country as a whole if we're ever faced with something like this in the future. I think, unfortunately, pandemics like this could actually become relatively common, in a highly interconnected and highly globalized world where we're all traveling across the world. It might be quite difficult to sort of stop the spread of these. So I think this is good preparedness that you know we are sort of learning for the future. But I think there'll also be some longer term learnings in terms of investing more in public health and boosting our public health infrastructure. You know, we're doing a lot on health insurance, we're doing a lot on hospitals, but we really need to shift more to the primary care, the public health, and some initiatives have been taken by the government. They've launched health and wellness centers, for instance, in the last few years. But I think all of this should get a boost after this, and this should be one of our biggest learnings, that if you really want to fight pandemics like this, you want to you know, ensure that there's minimal loss of life and productivity, because ultimately health, it's become clear to everybody, is not a social sector, it's as much an economic sector. And economies around the world are affected if you're losing people to health issues. So investment has to be in public health. We have to prevent diseases, or we have to tackle them at early stages and not let them advance. So I think, I would hope that this would be one of our biggest learnings out of this. It's a, you know, it's a very complex space. It's a very messy space. So I think that is something that has to be said at the outset. You know, we often come with our sort of expertise in different areas. Like, as I said, you know, I'm trained in life sciences, I'm trained in public health. And often intuitively, you know, this is the right thing to do. But trying to do it, you know, especially in a country of sort of our scale and diversities, and to balance all the multiple interests, you know, that are at play, the different stakeholders involved, to think of unintended consequences. So it's really a very, very complex sort of field. But I think it's equally a huge opportunity, and the learning is sort of unprecedented. I think just, you know, what I would have learned just in these few weeks, is something that, you know, you might ordinarily take months or even years to learn. So it's really steep learning curve. It's often very difficult. It can often feel frustrating, because, you know, sometimes you feel, why am I not seeing results? You know, I'm trying to do my best, but I'm really not seeing the results. So it's in many senses a very, very difficult space to be in. But I think it's very rewarding. If you are passionate, you know, about development work, and you, you know, you are passionate about helping people in different ways, I think it's one of the most rewarding sectors to also work in. My message, you know, would just be these are very difficult times for us, I think, for all of us in different ways. And we have to be away from each other. But I think that is the key, that, you know, we might be physically distant, but we must be socially, we must be emotionally very interconnected, so that, you know, people, we don't leave people out. Otherwise, there are plenty of people, you know, who can sort of be left out in this sort of scenario. So I think we have to be careful to still very much remain connected, remain integrated as people. And I think, you know, have a lot of empathy for those around us. There's many of, you know, of people around us who don't even have a home like we do. I think in India, this is something I say all the time, that physical distancing is something for the privileged. You know, I have a home, I can be in my home, I can distance myself. So many people can't. So we need to be very empathetic. While the government is trying to do its best at multiple levels, there's a lot that we as individuals can do. So I think whatever we can do to help people around us, to sort of, so that we can tide over these difficult times together, and sort of come out of these together.